Hello, this is Adolf. Welcome to the video lecture series on the course of Design of Steel Structures. In this video, we are going to see about the classification of steels, what are the grades of steel available in Indian market, what is their mechanical and physical properties of steel, what are their advantages and disadvantages of steel used as a structural member, and what are the types of load acting in the steel structures. First, we start with the classification of steel. So, based on the carbon content present in an iron, the steels are divided into three types. So, if the carbon content present in an iron lies between 0.1 to 0.25%, we will call it as a low carbon steels. If it is lies between 0.25 to 0.6%, we will call it as a medium carbon steels. If it is lies between 0.6% to 1.1%, we will call it as an high carbon steels. So these low carbon steels, we will call it as a mild steels. These mild steels is Fe250. Fe250. We use this mild steel in RCC construction as a reinforcement material or structural steel section used in a steel building construction. These as soon as the medium carbon steels where we will use is these medium carbon steels we use in rails, high tensile steels, hammers. Mostly these steels are Fe415. Next is high carbon steels. These steels were used to produce stone masonry tools, drills, punches, because they have high hardness, it can't easily broken. So as the carbon content increases, the yield strength of steel, ultimate tensile strength of steel, and the hardness of the steel increases, whereas it will decrease the ductility and toughness. So if we are going to use this steel in a structure, steel structural members, the hardness must be lesser to improve the weldability. So the ductility and toughness are very important for structural steel subjected to dynamic and impact loading. Further, steels are classified on the basis of their usages. First one is constructional steels. So these are used for structural members in steel structures. So they possess good weldability and satisfactory mechanical properties without additional heat treatment. Next is engineering steels. These engineering steels should have a higher strength under static and dynamic loadings. So it have a very good fabrication properties, and most of the engineering steels will undergo heat treatment. So these engineering steels are used to produce an engineering equipment which are used in the industry for the production purposes. Next is tool steels. These are intended for the manufacturing of cutting and measuring tools as well as dies. They have a very high hardness and wear resistance. These wear resistance have more than 0.7% of carbon. These tool steels are used to manufacturing the cutting and measuring tools. Most of the cutting and measuring tools are made from the tool steels only. Next is special steels. So these special steels have certain desired physical properties to suit their applications. So these includes magnetic and non-magnetic steels, stainless steels, heat resistant steels, corrosion resistant steels, and acid steels. So these are the classification of steels based on their usages. Next we see about the grades of steels. Some of the grades of steels that are manufactured in India for structural members. These table shows the grades of steel which are available in India for the structural members. So if it is Fe410O means it is an ordinary standard quality of steel having a ultimate tensile strength of 410 Newton per mm square. So if it is S means it is a standard quality. The IS code for standard quality is IS 226 year 1975. So W means it is a weldable quality. We can easily weld this steel. The IS code is IS 2062 1984. HT means high tensile quality steel. It will have a high tensile strength. See here, this tensile strength is 570 Newton per mm square. So the code for this grade of steel is IS 961 year 1975. So if it is given as a Fe510WHT means weldable high tensile quality steels. So these are the some of the grades of steel available in India. Mechanical properties of steel. These are the topics everyone must know in the steel structures. So first one is an hardness. So hardness is defined as the ability of a material to withstand friction and abrasion. So and what is it meant by toughness? So toughness is the ability of a material to absorb energy without fracturing or rupturing, or otherwise we can say it as a material's resistance to fracture when stressed. And a yield strength, force required to start the deformation of the material. Tensile strength, measurement of the force required to break the material. Yield strength, to start the deformation of the material. Tensile strength, required to break the material. Elongation or ductility, it is a degree to which material can be stretched or compressed before it breaks. In this table, we can see the ultimate tensile strength and the yield strength and elongation for the different types of steel. These standard structural steels, that is the Fe410S and Fe410W, that is standard quality and welded quality, will have the same mechanical properties, including the ultimate tensile strength, yield strength and the elongation. Whereas these micro alloyed high tensile strength steel having three different types of grades have these three will have different mechanical properties. So if you take Fe440, it will have a ultimate tensile strength of 440. 540 will have a ultimate tensile strength of 540 megapascal. Fe590 will have a 590 megapascal. So if the thickness of these members less than 16 mm, see here, this Fe540 will have the 440 will have the yield strength of 300 megapascal, whereas Fe540 will have 410 megapascal, whereas Fe590 will have 450 megapascal when the thickness of the members less than 16 mm. If these thickness of the member lies between 16 to 40, these Fe440 high tensile strength steel will have a yield strength of 290. Fe540 will have 390 megapascal and Fe590 will have 430 megapascal. If the thickness is greater than 40, the yield strength of the Fe440 is 280, Fe540 is 380 megapascal and Fe590 will be the 420 megapascal. So see here, if the thickness decreases, the yield strength of the micro alloyed high strength steel is increases. If the thickness decreases, yield strength increases. So what is the elongation? Elongation is for Fe440 it is 22, Fe540 it is 20, Fe590 it is 20. Next is advantages of a steel used as a structural members. Steel members have high strength per unit length. Therefore, a steel member of a small section which has little self weight is able to resist heavy load. Properly maintained steel structures have a long life. The properties of steel mostly do not change with time. So this makes steels the most suitable material for structure. A steel can be a ductile material, but it does not fall suddenly, but gives visible evidence of impending failures by loss, deflection. Then addition and alteration in the structural steel structures can be made easily. They can be erected at a faster rate, and a steel has a highest scrap value amongst all building material. These are the advantages of a steel. Next is a disadvantages. Steel structures, when placed in exposed condition, that steel members are subjected to corrosion. Therefore, they require frequent painting. So this will increase the cost, maintenance cost. Second is steel structures need fireproof treatment. This also increases the cost. Next, we see the types of loads in the steel members. So in the types of load, first we are going to see about the dead load. The first vertical load that is considered is dead load. Dead loads are permanent or stationary loads which are transferred to structure throughout its lifespan. So dead load is primarily due to self weight of structural members, permanent partition walls, fixed permanent equipments, and weight of different materials. It majorly consists of the weight of roofs, beams, walls, and columns, etc., which are otherwise the permanent parts of the building. The calculation of dead loads of each structure are calculated by the volume of each section and multiplied with unit weight. So the unit weight of some of the common materials are given in the tables. So for the brick masonry, it is 18.8 kilonewton per meter cube. If you take a timber, it is 5 to 8 kilonewton per meter cube. If it is a water, 10 kilonewton per meter cube. If you take a stone masonry, it is lies between 20.4 to 26.5 kilonewton per meter cube. So this is the sum of materials and their unit weight. So how we have to calculate the dead load? We have to calculate the volume of each section, and we have to multiply the volume of each section with the unit weight of the member material. Next is live load. The second vertical load that is considered in design of a structure is imposed load or live load. These live loads are either movable or moving load without any acceleration or impact. These loads are assumed to be produced by the intended user or occupant of the building, including weight of movable partitions or furniture, etc. These live loads keep on changing from time to time. These loads are to be suitably assumed by the designer. This load is one of the major load in the designs. The minimum values of the live load to be assumed are given in IS 875 Part 2 1987. It depends upon the intended use of the building. So this is IS 875 Part 2 1987 shows what are the live load we have to taken for the different buildings. So for taking a residential building, so you can take as a UDL or the concentrated loads. So if it is a dwelling house, you can take all rooms and kitchen will have a 2 in UDL concentrated 1.8 kilonewton. Likewise, you can see I have a every building, if it is an industrial building or storage building, assembly hall, or it is an commercial building, every building, they will, in this code, they will given their load for design purpose. Next is wind load. So wind load is primarily horizontal load caused by the movement of air relative to the earth. So wind load is required to be considered in natural design, especially when the height of the building exceeds 2 times the dimension transverse to the exposed wind surface. So for low rise buildings, say up to 4 to 5 stories, the wind load is not critical. Why? Because the moment of resistance provided by the continuity of floor system to the column connection and the walls provided between columns are sufficient to accommodate the effect of these forces. In the limit state method, the factor for design load is reduced to 1.2 times if we consider the dead load, live load and wind load. If you consider only dead load and live load, the factor of safety is 1.5 times. And the horizontal forces exerted by the components of wind is to be kept in mind while designing the building. The calculation of wind loads depend upon 2 factors, namely velocity of the wind and the size of the building. So the complete details of calculating wind loads on structures are given in IS 875 part 3 1987. So from the IS 875 part 3 1987, we have to first design a wind speed. We have to calculate the design wind speed of the of that zone. So the formula is V suffix Z is equal to VB K1 K2 K3. So VZ is a design wind speed at any height Z in meter per second. VB is basic maximum wind speed. K1 is a probability factor or risk coefficient. K2 is terrain height and structure size factor. And K3 is topography factor. So these VB value, K1, K2, K3, these values we can get it from the IS 875 part 3 1987, and we can design the building according to the wind load. Next is earthquake load. So earthquake forces constitute to both vertical and horizontal forces on the building. The total vibration caused by earthquake may be resolved into 3 mutually perpendicular directions, usually taken as vertical and 2 horizontal directions. The movement in vertical direction do not cause forces in superstructure to any significant extent. So we can neglect the vertical direction, but the horizontal movement of the building at the time of earthquake is to be considered while designing. The response of the structure to the ground vibration is a function of the nature of the foundation soil, size and mode of construction, and the duration and the intensity of ground motion. The IS code 1893 part 1 2002, it clearly gives the details of how this structure to be designed in the consideration of an earthquake load. As per IS 1893 part 1 2002, the India is divided into different zones. So if you take zone 5 in the Indian map, the red color shows the zone 5. This zone 5 is the highest risk zone, whereas in this highest risk zone, the earthquake is very frequent and very in a high range. So for this zone, the IS code assigns zone factor of 0.36. So what is this zone factor means? Maximum horizontal acceleration that can be experienced by a structure in this zone is 36% of gravitational acceleration. So the in this zone 5, that is 36% of gravitational acceleration are experienced by a building in that zone. So this zone 5 is referred as a very high damage risk zone, because in this zone 5 the magnitude of the earthquake will be higher and it will frequently occurs. Zone 4 is a yellow, that is orange color in map, the orange color. So zone 4 is high damage risk zone. This is zone 4, this is zone 5. So zone 4 is a high damage risk zone. So the IS code assigned zone factor is 0.24. in zone 5 zone factor is 0.36, in zone 4 it is 0.24, and zone 3 is yellow color in the map. This is zone 3. It is a moderate damage risk zone, and the zone factor for this zone is 0.16. and zone 2 is blue color, and it is a low damage risk zone, and the zone factor is 0.10. and in India there will be no zone 1. No area of India is classified as a zone 1. So these details we can get it from the IS 1893. So from the IS 1893 part 1, we can design our building according to the earthquake load. So the design seismic base shear is calculated by BB is equal to A suffix H into W. So the H suffix H is design horizontal acceleration spectrum value, and W is seismic weight of the building. So how we can find the AHS formula is Z by 2, I by R, SA by G. So these zone factors, Z is zone factor, I is importance factor, R is response reduction factor, and SA by G is response acceleration coefficients. These factors we can get it from the IS 1893 part 1. So we can get this from the IS 1893 part 1 2002. Next is impact load. So impact load can be computed by multiplying live load with the impact factors. So these are the type of structures and their impact factor in percentage. So if a frame supporting lifts and hoists, its impact factor will be 100%, and if it is light machinery shaft motor unit, it is 20. Installed machinery, it is 20 again. So these are the types of structures and their impact factors. So how we have to calculate the impact load? So multiplying the live load with this impact factor will give you the live load. Next is temperature and erection effects. So due to fluctuation in temperature, the structural members expand or contract and produce some loading effect in the members. So in a statically determined system, the effluence of temperature is basically to change the member length and cause the secondary stresses. So the stresses are sometimes very prominent and may be to the order of 25% of the live load. Therefore, for structures like bridges, trusses must be given to the consideration of the temperature effect. The erection loads are temporary loads which come into play during the construction only. These also should be carefully assessed. So these are the some of the references you can follow. And in the today's classes, we see the classification of steels, the classification of steels based on the carbon content and the based on the usage. Next is the what are the grades of steel available in the Indian market. Then we see the mechanical and physical properties and the advantages and disadvantages. And finally, we saw the types of load in the steel structures. Thank you for listening this video.